Well, first of all, I would like to thank the organizer and apologize because there are two things for which I'm not gifted. I have many French archaeologists, is surrising archaeology and speaking English, and I will try to do both. So maybe I should shut up and go out right now. I try my best. Well, heterogeneous heterarchies, this is a title I chose when I introduced the abstract. I realized when I dealt with the topic that the title could have been quite different: heterogeneous hierarchies, homogeneous heterarchies. The question tag allows a lot of combinations. Yes, indeed, we will remain in the pretty much the same area, but a bit more to the north. Here, precisely, is in the northern part of the Iberian world. Iberian, when referring to Iron Age, refers to an archaeological culture generally dated from the 6th century onward, but here we will consider also earlier centuries of the first millennium BC. I will focus on the political side of the concept of heterarchy, with the aim to discuss its, if I may, its heuristic value in the specific context of the Iberian Iron Age. I was initiated to this concept through some email exchanges we had with Mary, and I must confess that it was for me a bit of a discovery, as heterarchy seemed to be totally alien to French archaeologists and is not used at all in the discussion concerning the social structures of the Mediterranean Iron Age. Yet I'm happy to have coped with this topic, and I hope to be able to make you understand why. Investigation about Western Mediterranean Iron Age social structure is strongly dominated by a more or less rigid socio-evolutionist approach. This situation is largely due to the attractiveness as a city-state political model among the archaeologists. This kind of political structure, present in the Iron Age Western Mediterranean through the Phoenician and Greek colonies, seems to be considered as a final evolutionary step of any Mediterranean polity. As a matter of fact, there were native city-states coining money and characterized by an advanced level of institutional formalism in Iberia. But their existence is only clear from the end of the 3rd century BC onward, mainly, in my opinion, as a consequence of the Roman conquest of Hispania after the Second Punic War. Yet, many colleagues are dealing with this topic as a rather disruptive process introduced by the Roman rule were indeed the ultimate consequences of specifically native dynamics. Asamarti is among the first and surely the most important of those who try to define an evolution pattern through three steps, from small-scale societies to territorial polities and then to archaic states. This model puts the emphasis on the role of the elite and of their capacity on mobilizing agricultural surpluses that could be exchanged against imported goods. More recent models also insist on the reinforcement of the capacity of coercion by the elite, a term Samarty doesn't use, however. Through the control of both economic resources and military structure, these elites could have ensured for their community a political and institutional stability, who would have led to the emergence of kingship with a G as a feature for power. In France, the emphasis lies much more on the settlement patterns, but the evolutionist perspective is also very present. The native settlements are supposed to assume towards the 4th, 3rd century BC an urban nature, thus reducing the evolutionary gap between themselves and their neighboring Greek colonies. I think that, indeed, this socio-evolutionist focus hinders a realistic analysis of how actually work Iberian hierarchies. It focuses the attention on the supposed emergence of new institutions to the detriment of long-term structures, probably more important in the everyday experience of an Iberian community. What I would like to discuss here with you today are precisely this long-term socio-political structure and see how the heterarchy concept may help to understand them better. The hierarchy of the word heterarchy refers to power, archae in Greek. What are the structure of power of the northern Iberian world? This is what I would like to discuss. What seems to me quite clear is that the access to power is a result in the specific context of a competitive process potentially involving, in one way or another, the world community. What resources, what means can be used in such competitive process? The first one, in my opinion, may be the mobilization of a group within the society that will cooperate in serving the interest of one individual or a small group of individuals. The first essential group that can be mobilized in this sense is a kin group. The existence of this kind of feature is quite difficult to assert. The best way today to deal with it through the spatial analysis is through the spatial analysis of necropolises. And as a matter of fact, above all in Aragon and Western Catalonia, and probably also in some part of Southern France, we have some hints showing that kinship, without G this time, kinship, may be a structuring fact within the funerary space, even if the impossibility of DNA analysis doesn't allow to be really affirmative. As for settlements, we have, I think, good evidence to demonstrate that in some cases, the domestic units were much more important than only one nuclear family, i.e. father, mother and sons. The structure of some very big houses, the capacity of their storage facilities, the repetitiveness of some activities, and in some specific context epigraphy, show clearly that the domestic unit may have numbered more than 10 persons. I already proposed that these large domestic groups could be interpreted as lineages or segments of lineages whose members are residing in the same houses. Yet it appears quite clearly that this kind of spatial incarnation of kinship without G, doesn't concern the whole of the community. The most radical example of that may be the first century settlement of El Sestinclés near Lleida in Western Catalonia. Here, a hierarchy between big houses, big houses to the south, medium houses to the east, and small houses to the north. So, I shouldn't left my leaflet. So a hierarchy between big houses, medium houses, and small houses appear clearly, and I think that it can be interpreted as a reflection of the fact that elite kin groups to the south were also larger groups than those of the most evilly dominated people, if I may, that may have been even deprived for those to the north, to the right, to build their own family. I think this tendency of the elite on strengthening... I think that this tendency of the elite in strengthening kin solidarities through co-residency. Is an inheritance of the late Bronze Age. It should be a bit more fancy, but well. And as a matter of fact, one of the Puig Sant Andreu bigger houses, third century settlement of Puig Sant Andreu bigger houses, seem very close, both in shape and size, to the much earlier Poblado El Calle Central of Genoa from the late Bronze Age. I don't mean through this example that large building like the Puig Sant Andreu house is some kind of recent version of the Poblado El Calle Central of the late Bronze Age, adapted to insert itself in a bigger settlement. But what I would like to stress is that the structure of the group inhabiting both buildings can be the same. Beyond the lineage scale, we can also imagine, and in some cases strongly suspect, that a military retinue, probable in the case of the Elsular fortress, as well as a clientele, could have played a significant role in the competition for power. Beyond the limits of the community itself, the construction of a network of friends able to provide assistance could have been a crucial issue. In some cases, these networks seem to have connected people from very different regions, probably because a far-reaching network could also bring prestige to people involved in it. A second point for me, crucial to understand this competition, is the fact that economic power, that the control of economic resources in order to redistribute and exchange them, could be a very, very central point. The main bigger houses from the end of the 7th century, at least onward, are both places of production and accumulation of goods. This can probably be interpreted as a proof that elite domestic units were involved in important redistribution processes, the very same ones that may have granted them a wide retinue and a huge number of clients. Obviously, agrarian resources must have been the one prominently mobilized in this context, but they are probably not the only ones. The association of specific crafts with specific elite buildings suggests a direct involvement of elite domestic units in these crafts. In my opinion, the discovery of molds for melting copper alloy in Tossal Montañas, the importance of iron metallurgy in Mascastella de Pontos, in some cases probably also of silver jewelry, suggests more than the existence of a workplace operated by an outsider during working hours. It suggests, indeed, that people belonging to the domestic units themselves were actually bronzesmiths, silversmiths, etc. In my opinion, the domination of a very specific, advanced, and complex know-how may play an active part in the construction of the identity of some people belonging to the elite, as may also confirm the 4th century goldsmithdom from Cabezo Lucero a bit more to the south, with these goldsmith tools in a very rich tomb, also where weapons were also presented. Well, this is the last time I show this kind of picture, because now I'm ashamed by that. But let's say that it may give an idea of the worthiness of the effort I referred to previously. If you think about redistribution, the fact to be able to distribute fine goods, obviously, can help to convince people to become one's client, for example. But it also appears as logic if you are thinking about those huge elite networks I previously told you about. What can make stronger an interpersonal bond, than the exchange of gifts whose fabrication involved one or both partners? Think also about intra-communitarian and competitive processes in a don contre don fashion, where competition resides in the exchange of good. The better craft person you are, the better will be your position in this specific arena. The acquisition of prestige through war, armed violence, and let's say more generally through symbolism linked with violence. In most of the necropolises, weapons are ubiquitous. In the grave were ascribed to male people. In the settlements, severed heads could be exhibited as well as weapons. Engraved stele will remain the fortunes of the misfortune of some warrior, if you focus on the guy on the ground. Prowess at war, or even the ability to enforce one's position within the community through the use of armed violence or the display of armored force, could have been a powerful way to promote oneself. I'm not sure that modesty would have helped a lot for the conquest of power in this context. Public ostentation of wealth, markers of a specific status, or indeed of anything related with what I previously told about, military strength, technical skill, far-ranging networks, etc., is another aspect of this competition. As such, it's very difficult to isolate this point, this ostentation point, from the other one. What is, in my opinion, really significant is that most of these ostentatious practices are focused on households. Houses are monumental, skulls are mainly exhibited outside houses, as words were. Craftwork takes place within the domestic space. Ostentation of anything, in my opinion, serves one purpose: to build a tale associated with a house, associated itself with a lineage, and beyond, with the individuals leading it. The aim of all that, in my opinion, is to accumulate prestige through generations, hoping that one day it will allow not forcefully yourself, but maybe your heirs to seize power. Long-time strategies based on the accumulation of symbolic capital, to quote Bourdieu. All the elements I told about could have been associated in very different manners, and this is what matters. This is not, no people must have made that forcefully. Some may have focused on war, others on craftwork, others on architecture, for example. So all these elements could have been associated in very different manners, from one place to another, from one time to another, but they are always present, at least from the early Iron Age onward. This means that, whatever the contextual political structure, highly variant from one place to another, in my opinion, the grammar of power is the same one. Socio-evolutionist models are based on the often untold idea that that one system will substitute itself to another. In my opinion, it doesn't match the reality. A socio-political system can be better re-described as a stratigraphy. Evolution can bring new upper layers, but the lower layers do not disappear, they are only buried a bit deeper. I think what I describe is really the basic layers of the Iberian socio-political system, the fact that elites are interested in power and that power is obtained through competition. What does it mean from our point of view today? I already told you about the settlement of Alcestine Clays. Doesn't look that heterarchical indeed. Seems rather to be the special expression of the hierarchy. But Alcestine Clays is a very short-lived settlement, active for some two or three generations on the 3rd century BC, according to the authors. In this short term, hierarchy seems strong and clear. But let's consider it in another way, the long time, the temps long in French. I will be frank, I think I gave you a very reductive idea of the many items one could use to promote himself and his lineage. Yet think how many different strategies are possible only through the use of these few items. In other words, we can think about the elite, we cannot think about the elite as a homogeneous class, sharing equally the access to the power, but rather as a very heterogeneous part of the society, in my opinion, much more open to newcomers than we used to think. A part of the society composed of elements that can be ranked in many different ways according to a process that could last over many generations. A hierarchy, a hierarchy on the short term, but a heterarchy on the long term. As a conclusion, I would like to stress the fact that, from my point of view, thinking about Iberian societies as heterarchical societies helps to give account of the fluidity of their structure, as well as the dynamics of the processes according which process power structures take shapes. Thinking about heterarchy as a long-term dynamic process through which hierarchies acquire their shape, allow us to understand why, at some moment, for instance, the end of the 3rd century BC here, we can observe so many different forms of hierarchies from one place to another, expressing themselves through different relations to space. That's because each one is a product of a specific dynamic, of a long-term heterarchical process specific to each polity in which agency plays a major role. Thanks a lot for your patience.